Hello, it's Run again, and this is session 15 of painting Carla in the Rose Garden. This is a pure sable fan brush. Now, I don't know where I got these brushes. I've had them for years. It's so old, I've had to put a new handle on it. Somewhere along the line, I lost one. I got two. Oh, many, many years ago, probably 40 years or more ago. And I treasure this brush. I don't often use it. It's tucked away. I had to have a search for it. I knew it would be perfect for laying down some of the fine hairs, the golden retriever, just where the light catches them in the garden, with a bit of natural sunlight. yes, well, I decided today that given that with yesterday's activities, I only got one painting session in the evening, I would try to start my painting sessions earlier in the morning. Well, of course, the downside of that is I hadn't had enough cups of coffee, and instead of turning seven lights on to illuminate my painting, I only turned five on. Now, one would think that would be enough, but you'd be surprised how much daylight lighting one needs to eliminate all shadows when you're painting. And, well, I missed two important ones, so I hope you'll forgive me. Anyway, this sand brush is doing a lovely job of putting down multiple hairs at one time. You need to dance the brush around. It's practice. Don't just pull it directly down in one position. You need to change the position. Sometimes you need to just get up onto a couple of hairs. You don't have to have this brush to do the job, but it's a very convenient brush for this particular job. And as I said, I very rarely use the brush, but I look at the subject and let the subject suggest to me how it needs to be painted. And, well, my subject suggested get that fan brush out. You could do it with a hog hair fan brush, but, of course, you wouldn't have the lightness of touch that you get with a pure sable. I am, of course, working with opaque watercolour now, gouache, because I felt that the lightest, brightest hairs of the golden retriever were lighter than my paper. The paper I work with is off-white, creamy coloured, so when I want to get a really bright white, I do need to use opaque gouache to achieve that. So I'm really working through studying where the darkest darks are on the golden retrievers, and where the lightest lights are at this point of the painting. And that's really all I'll be doing in this session 15 of the painting, is looking hard into the patterns of light and shade and trying to render them correctly, because that is what is going to give the characteristics of the dog. This is where you cannot use a formula on how to draw a face or any subject, because each of these dogs has a different character. They don't fit a formula where, you know, the eyes are so far down in the head and then the nose must be so far down again. And also those rules that one may read or be shown, they don't apply to how you tilt the head. They don't apply to the sideways movement or the up and down movement, with where you've got foreshortening, and certainly they don't show the variation of character of each dog, because Conan, that I'm painting now, has a head nothing at all like Kira's head. So this is where you must look for the pattern of light shade in your subject and focus on putting those patterns of light and shade in, and that's how you get likeness in a portrait. And with watercolour, you need patience. You need to allow the water to do it. If you work on slightly damp paper, then the brush mark that you put down will bleed slightly. And that's perhaps useful for around the head here, but where I was putting those hairs in, I wanted to have a little bit of crisp edge. And so I worked with a dry brush work. That's where I had fairly dry paint on my brush and I put it down onto dry paper. So that was basically a dry brush stroke. Now, to be skilled at watercolor, you need to master each of the four main ways of working with your paint. You have wet on wet, that's where you load the brush with a very wet wash and you put it down onto very wet paper. And then you can have dry on wet, and that's where you put down a fairly dry brush stroke, whereas I have now, where the brush is loaded up with paint but not much water, and you put it down onto wet paper. And then you have, basically, you've got the dry on dry, as we're doing now, where the paper is relatively dry and my paintbrush is relatively dry, because I'm putting down highlights, and so I'm looking for a fairly crisp edge with those highlights. Three, two, one. I've changed back to my pure sable pointed brush here, and now I've come in with a very fine, probably about a zero pure sable brush, and I have wet the paper so that when I put these dark marks in, they're bleeding out. So this again becomes almost wet because it's not a wash, it's a damp brush being put down onto damp paper. And so the edges of the shadow that I put down bleed off into a soft line. And then I can pull those shadows into that damp paper to soften the line further, because those shadows need to be built up gradually. You do it gradually because it's not easy to remove paint with watercolor. So when you're building up darks in an area as sensitive as a portrait, where you don't want to come on too strong and then find that you've perhaps put down the dark too intensely and it needs removing, you would build the darks up very, very gradually. And you watch how much it bleeds away. And you've just got to control that water a little bit, but you've also got to allow the water to be doing it. You mustn't be too controlled. You don't want hard edges. You don't want it stylized. You want to have a natural look. And you need it to show that the water has done a lot of the painting by the subtle merging as the paint bleeds out into that dampened paper. Again, we're wanting to get the characteristics of the dog. We're needing this dog to look like Kira. So we keep referring back to the image we're working from of Kira, and we're gradually building up. And again, we're still working with the colours that we've worked with for the whole painting. These are the colours that are over on the palette from where we did the initial blocking. So the cobalt blue and the viridian green are forming the basis of our darker cool colours, and the cadmium red and the cadmium orange are forming the basis of our warm colours. And we know by now that if we combine those colours together, we're going to get greys or browns, depending on the variation of them. Sometimes they'll look like a blue-grey, sometimes they'll look like a warm red-brown. It just depends on the combination of those shadow patterns that we're putting together using those colours. And as I said, we've got to build this up very gradually, and we're working, as I said, onto the damp paper, because we don't want these dark marks to form hard, unnatural, sharp edges. We're focusing very carefully on where the pattern of these shadows go. It's not something you can rush. Things like the white of the eye, they're misnames. The white, the lighter part of the eye is not white. It perhaps is a blue-grey, but it's definitely not white, and it's never the lightest part. The eye is always in shadow. You know, you can't stare at the sun. Your eyebrow is there to cast your eye in shadow if the sun is directly above you. You know yourself, if the sun's glaring in your eye, you'll put your hands up to shade your eye. Therefore, you're never going to have the white of the eye looking white. So don't worry too much about preserving the white in the eye. You can't rush this. As I said, it's a gradual referring to the subject you're painting, looking for the dark. If you're working through the darks, look where the dark is, and then back to your subject. Look where it's different, and then put your darks in to match what you see in your subject. So portraiture is very much a thing of looking at your subject, looking at your paper or your canvas, assessing what is different as regards light and shade. And if you see something is darker in the subject you're painting, you look for that spot on your paper or your canvas, and you make it darker in that spot. You try not to think in terms of this is an eye, this is a nose, this is a mouth. You try to think in terms of patterns of light and shade. How long would you estimate to take to do a painting like this? Well, if I was teaching intermediate to advanced students in a 3-hour class, I would probably allocate 2 3-hour classes for them to complete a work like this, with me demonstrating alongside them aspects of the painting and constructively critiquing as they go. And it's possible that some students might have needed 3 by 3-hour classes to complete the work, and some of my more advanced students might have been near completing it in 1 3-hour class. And if I was demonstrating it at my peak, I probably would have completed most of the painting in the 3-hour class demonstration and maybe gone back to a couple of touch-ups in another one. So that would be equivalent to about 18 of these 10-minute demonstrations in real time for you. So we'll see how we go. That would indicate that I'd have at least another 3 of these demonstrations to go, and maybe even more. Just depends how we go with the water doing exactly what I want, and that's something you can't guarantee with watercolour. You've always got to allow that the water's the master and you're trying to control the master. But so far, I think Carla would be pretty pleased. I think I've captured Kira and Conan's likeness quite well. So the next trick will be capturing Carla's likeness even more. So we're still, as I said, puddling away here, and that's what we're doing, mixing paint, the puddle of paints over there. We're looking to get the tone we want, the tone being more important than the colour, although we're more likely to have the cooler colours in the darker tones, that would be your blues or your greens, and we're more likely to have the warmer colours, the red or the orange, in the lighter tone areas. So we're just undercutting now, a bit of shadow under the tail, a little shadow under the body, a little shadow under the face of the feet, and we will have finished this session of working on Kira and Conan. We're trying to get a little bit darker, so we've hit back into the pan paints, combining the cobalt blue, the cadmium red, trying to get a much darker tone because we're just going for shadows, just undercutting the dog there where we've been working. It's really pleasurable painting a dog because as they develop, you start to see that dog looking at you. And if you're a dog lover, that's just a nice feeling to start recognizing your dog. So I'll look forward to seeing you in the next demonstration.